You're listening to the Chad Easty Show on demand. Good for you. Now download the KFYO app and listen live weekday afternoons, 5 to 7 p.m. Central.
Broadcasting from the great state of Texas, this is the Chad Easty Show. News and views with a Lone Star perspective. You can sound off during the show by sending Chad a text at 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. Or call in at 1-800-687-0790. Now, here's Chad Easty.
Amarillo, Abilene, Wichita Falls, Midland, Odessa, Dallas, Fort Worth, down in Houston, over in El Paso, and anywhere else inside or outside the great state of Texas, wherever you may be listening on this Monday, October 7th, 2024. Welcome into the program. Glad to have you with us today, wherever you may be listening, whether you're stuck in traffic somewhere, maybe you're still at the office, maybe you're at home already, maybe you're working out of the home office, maybe you're outside firing up the grill on this Monday, whatever you may be doing, thank you very much for tuning in to today's edition of the program, where we've got just a ton of things to talk about. A lot of news, a lot of issues to get into. Want to hear from you on a variety of things today. We'll be talking about the Supreme Court and the state of Texas. We'll get into that. We've got Kim Sansom with the Silver Spur Trade Show's Gun and Blade Show. She'll be joining us coming up right about 5:48 or so this evening, as we've got the Gun and Blade Show coming back to the Hub City, and we've got tickets that we'll be giving away to that event. So stick with us throughout the show for your chance to win tickets to the Gun and Blade Show. Scott Braddock will join us at 6:05 this evening. We've also got a little bit of news on Kamala Harris and the election before us. Some very interesting numbers out of the betting arena, where bettors are now saying that their money's going towards Donald Trump winning the election. What does that actually mean? We'll get into that. And could the election be thrown off by millions of Christians who will not be voting in the election? We'll get into that story coming up here in just a little bit. Want to hear from you today on the text line at 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. You can text in, let us know your thoughts on any of the topics of the day, any of the other stories that you want to comment on. Feel free to do so. Be sure to give us your name and where you're listening from whenever you text in to the show. And, of course, you can also give us a call, 1-800-687-0790. That's 1-800-687-0790. You can give us a call as well. And all you have to do is get past the first voice you hear from. When you dial in today, he's back. He's back from a raucous weekend.
Yeah.
It's Nick. Nick, how are you today?
I'm doing very well.
Yeah.
It was a great weekend.
Yeah.
And in fact, I hear Amy, who filled in on Friday. She did an excellent job.
Amy did a fantastic
job.
That
is good to hear.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. She said you guys talked about scary movies.
Yeah.
Which I knew you love those. So I knew it had to have been a good show.
I was shocked at how much Amy loved scary movies.
It scares me when she is, she knows everything about scary movies. She's seen probably every single scary movie out there, and she likes it.
Yeah, she likes everything scary. She likes haunted houses. Yeah. She likes it. But if you were to meet Amy,
right,
sweet Amy, as we like to call her around here, she doesn't seem like she has a mean bone in her body or a someone who would like anything scary at all.
She has she's notorious for enjoying Barbies.
Yes.
As a kid, you know, pink.
Even now, I think. Even
probably. She likes Taylor Swift, you know? Yes. It's just it goes against what you would think when you hear, "Oh, she loves horror movies."
Yeah.
It's you don't think Amy.
The scarier the better for her.
Yeah. Yeah. It's creepy, but you know, hey, if she enjoys it, that's always good, but
absolutely.
Yeah, no, I heard you guys talking about that, which a lot of fun. But I think I got you beat with my fun over the weekend.
Really?
I got up at between 3:30 and 4.
Oh,
on Sunday morning.
Okay.
All day of flying.
Yes.
Got back home. I slept for 15 hours. I fell asleep at 3:30 p.m. I woke up at 7 this morning.
Yeah.
No break in between. Completely out the entire time. But hey, it was a lot of fun. Got to see my friend that I haven't seen in 10 years.
Okay, so this was the wedding of the friend that you haven't seen.
This was the one.
In 10 years. You've barely spoken to in more than 10 years.
We've texted probably 4 times.
Yeah.
In about a decade.
Okay.
So, but it the thing is, though, we were so close.
Yeah.
Back then, that it was a little awkward before we talked, because it was like, whoa, you know, this is weird. I haven't seen it. But then once we started talking to each other, it was like no time has passed.
Right. And isn't that awesome?
Exactly.
You know, about great friends and great friendships that, because I've got a few friends that we haven't really spoken since, you know, I mean, even before then, like high school, basically, you know, where, I mean, we just kind of lost touch. And I've met up with someone, and you can just pick up like that.
Yep.
And it seems like no time has passed.
Yep. And to make it even better, so I brought my fiance came along, and obviously she's never met him before.
Yeah.
When they introduced, or when I introduced her and they got to meet for the first time, he immediately brought up some, I don't know, zany thing that we were up to, because we were in the same building that we grew up with. We were in this big building that we used to go to all the time.
Yeah.
And so there's this big hallway, and we used to get in trouble all the time in that hallway as when we were really, really young. And so, of course, he brought up a whole bunch of stories like that. And my fiance, she was laughing about it, but probably a little concerned about me. But hey, I grew up fine, I think. it was a lot of fun seeing people. It's funny, too, because all of the adults look identical.
Yeah.
10 years gone by, maybe a few more gray hairs.
Sure.
But they look identical.
Yeah.
The kids, they're all 8 feet tall now.
Do you put yourself in the kid category? What do you put yourself in?
It's hard. I put myself as like a third party.
Okay.
I don't consider myself part of the kids or part of the adults. I'm just there.
Yeah.
I'm just there as a witness, and I was a witness back then, and now I am again. And so when you add 10 years to, you know, kids that I knew who were younger than me, who were, say, 10 years old.
Sure.
I mean, they're 20 now.
Yeah.
Some of them, so many of my friends now, I heard that they graduated. They went to grad school. They're done with that.
Yeah.
They live in North Carolina,
sure,
and they work here.
Yeah.
It's so weird.
Yeah.
Seeing all these kids. Two kids that I babysat. I think they were 7 years old. They're, you know, in high school now, about to finish high school. And that's just, I saw pictures of them at prom. It's just, it is mind-blowing how people
change. You're getting
older.
That's what that means. You're getting older.
It's so weird. Yeah. Such a weird thing. But, I mean, it was great to see people, old family friends, and, again, people I haven't seen in so long. So,
well, it's like, I know some people who, and this always, this kind of blows my mind, too. Mm-hmm. I've got a friend of mine who their kid, okay, and we graduated around the same time from high school. Their kid is coming out to Texas Tech to take a look at going to Texas Tech.
Does it make you feel old?
Yes, of course it does. Absolutely it does.
Yeah.
And so they're asking me, hey, Can you? What do you think? What are some of the go-to places? Yeah. You know, in Lubbock, and I'm like, well, for college kids or for like the old people yeah. like me, I don't know. I can't really help you out with the college kids, but yeah.
It's always leave it up to friends and family to really make you feel old.
Yes.
And not really intentionally.
No, well, it's just, sometimes.
Sometimes, yeah. Some family, some friends.
Yeah.
But, you know, it just time moves on too. Like, you know, I only see my parents, what, once every 6 months to 12 months?
Yeah.
And same thing. It's like, you know, you have this image of them.
Right.
And then, you know, 6 months later, a year later, it's like, whoa, are you dyeing your beard white? What's going on here? Yeah. Why?
what's going on?
Why do you look a little different than you did a year ago?
Yeah.
And I don't know.
But, yeah. That's no fun.
No, it is not.
It's not fun, my friend. Let me tell you, it's not fun. and then you'll get to the point where they'll start because I've noticed this with my mom and dad, mm-hmm. and they're both in good health, all that right, kind of good right, stuff. Right. So you know which is great. But I've, you know, obviously, you know, you notice changes mm-hmm. in your appearance. Like my dad now, instead of falling asleep at 10 p.m., 8 p.m., he's out. He's done. You know, 8 p.m., he's done. He, if he's on the couch, it's over at that time. And then where they would, my dad would complain about my mom keeping the house too warm.
Okay.
This, like, 10 years ago.
Right.
He would complain, oh, it's too warm in the house.
Yeah.
Now he's always cold. And it's getting, you know, like that that little thermostat has kind of stayed towards the warmer side in the house. And it's like, this is different.
And you know what? Sometime down the road, I think you'll be sitting at home with your wife.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden you'll be like, you know what? I'm a little chilly. You know, so what happened? Ten years ago, I was great.
A front has come through. My goodness.
Yeah.
Time does move. Yep. That's for sure. 806-680-2790. So today's running topic, we're going to start looking at doing this, the best and worst from over the weekend. And this can be kind of anything. Best thing that you had for dinner over the weekend, worst thing you had for dinner. Best thing that happened over the weekend, worst thing that happened over the weekend. Give us your best and your worst from over the weekend. You can text in at 806-680-2790. Like for me, the best from over the weekend, we spent a lot of time outdoors, actually. We went to Dogtoberfest. We had some nice time out there, and then we went and did a little fishing this weekend. Just beautiful, beautiful weather this weekend that we got to enjoy. So that was the best for us. The worst thing was I noticed after three beers I got home, took a little nap for a few hours. That didn't used to happen. When I was a college kid, that didn't happen. Now I get home and I'm like, a little tired after those beers. That was a little bit weird. 806-680-2790. You can text in. You can also give us a call, 1-800-687-0790. When we come back, we'll get into some of the news of the day, your text messages, and more.
The Chad Hastie Show can be heard all over West Texas, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m. Tune in on News Talk 95.1 and 790 KFYO in Lubbock, News Talk 940 in Amarillo, News Talk 94.7 and 1470 KYYW in Abilene, and in Wichita Falls on News Talk 96.3 and 1290. The Chad Hastie Show. Make it a part of your drive home, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton. Tuesday edition, Clay and Buck, 28 days, 4 weeks until Election Day. What is the absolute latest? We will break it down for you. Major hurricane barreling towards Florida. We'll certainly be talking about that. Buck.
Looking into the latest in the polls, Clay mentioned that election. We've just got weeks here, friends. Can Kamala turn it around? We'll discuss on Clay and Buck.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton, tomorrow morning at 11.
All right, back on the Chad Hastie Show. Thank you very much for tuning in today. Happy Monday. 806-680-2790. You can send in your thoughts on the app chat as well. If you're listening to us on the app, just send us a message on there. Check in. Say hello. Would love to know where you're streaming the show from today. You can check in on the app chat. We always enjoy getting those messages. Let's see. Patrick from Lawton saying, I heard your question, and I want to say that I came from a middle-class family. Yeah, that is the standard answer there, Patrick. Very good. Another question, another text here. I'm hearing that a lot of Harris voters in North Carolina are mad as heck over the federal response and are switching their vote to Trump. I haven't seen any official polling on that. I don't know how you would do any polling right now on that, and especially the affected parts of North Carolina, where those areas have just been decimated. It would surprise me. Look, I think the diehard Democrats, I don't think this is going to make them switch to Donald Trump. It would surprise me if this made them switch their vote to Donald Trump. Maybe some of those who have been on the fence, maybe some of those who are only going to vote for Kamala Harris because they don't like how mean Donald Trump is on social media. You know, those type of Democrats or Republicans or independents that, you know, they're the wishy-washy. I could see them say, okay, obviously we need a better federal response. Obviously we need a better priority when it comes to where to spend taxpayer money. But this is also why, and again, there is obviously the federal role here that needs to play a part in going in and in helping and rescuing and securing these areas. But this is also something where, remember, you can't rely on the government. This does need to be a lesson for so many people that you cannot rely on the government to be there for you when we see their priorities. We see their priorities year after year, sending our money overseas. And, you know, meanwhile, we have Americans who are suffering. And it's not just through storms that they're suffering. We have homeless veterans that are suffering in the United States. We have people who are suffering here at home. And we send millions and millions, billions of dollars in taxpayer money overseas to make other people feel more comfortable. And so it's something that I would hope that it would change some people's minds and maybe their votes. But I think the vast majority of people who may be switching their votes are people who are kind of on that fence. If you're just a diehard Democrat from North Carolina, diehard Democrat who could, you know, never vote for Donald Trump, you're going to vote for Kamala Harris, you've voted Democrat your entire life, then yeah, I don't see that person switching at all. 806-680-2790. Lori from Dover, Delaware, checking in on the app chat. Hello to you. Howdy to you, Lori. Thanks for checking in on the app chat. Love to hear that. Let's see, another texture weighed in. The best thing that happened over their weekend, bought two show pigs. The worst thing, bought two show pigs. That's from the texture weighed in at 806-680-2790. You can get in and sound off on any of the topics that we've been talking about today. SCOTUS letting stand the Texas court order that hospitals are not required to do abortions, violating state law. The Supreme Court Monday let stand an appeals court decision barring emergency abortions in Texas that violate state law, one of the country's strictest abortion bans. the justices announced their decision without detailing their reasoning, according to the Associated Press. The Biden administration had asked the nine high court justices to throw out the Fifth U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals order, arguing that hospitals have to perform abortions in emergency situations under federal law, the wire service reported. And so the Supreme Court tossed, or Supreme Court letting stand the appeals court decision. I'm not too surprised by that, but you never know when it goes to the Supreme Court or any court what their ruling is going to be or how they're going to let things play out. And this is a obviously a big decision in Texas and a big decision nationally as well, or at least to allow the decision to stand is something big. 806-680-2790. Texter, my wife's going through menopause and she's freezing me out. Another texter, was Nick's friends in North Carolina devastated in the devastated area because of the hurricane? That from Mary in Lubbock. Were they, Nick? No. That's good. Let's see. Another Robert saying, come on, guys. Y'all are young whippersnappers. Talk to me when you start flatulating dust. Talk about napping. I've got no problem rolling out of bed. It's getting off the floor after the fact is the problem. When we come back, your phone calls, your text, and much more. The Chad Easty Show brought to you in part by First Bank and Trust Texas. FirstBankTexas.com.
Mama, what does the chicken say? Dog. Cat. Giraffe.
Giraffe.
You're not going to get it all right. Just make sure you nail the big stuff, like making sure your kids are buckled correctly in the right seat for their age and size. Get it right.
Visit NHTSA.gov/the right seat.
Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
We're pretty much a sleepy little town.
Yep.
But when the oil starts booming, we get way more traffic. Cars, pickups, big trucks, not to mention the speeders.
And texters.
Yep. And when that happens, we're not sleepy anymore.
Nope, we're real movers and shakers.
Did you really say movers and shakers?
I did.
That's so 80s.
Well, I am 80.
When business is booming, the roads get crowded. Slow down, give big trucks a lot of room, and pay attention.
Be safe.
Drive smart.
Brought to you by TxDOT.
The news and talk of West Texas. News Talk 95.1 and 790 KFYO. Don't you forget about Chad. At Chad Hasty Radio on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and on your radio. Now, back to the Chad Hasty Show.
All right, back on the Chad Hasty Show. Thank you very much for tuning in today. You can text in 806-680-2790. Your running topic today, best, worst, over the weekend. The best thing, the best whatever from over the weekend. And also the worst, whatever it was, from over the weekend. You can get those in. You can get in on the text line at 806-680-2790. Story out of, or this is from justthenews.com. Headline, millions of Christians not planning to vote this November. The Cultural Research Center at Arizona Christian University study found that approximately 104 million people under the People of Faith umbrella not expected to vote, including 41 million Christians and 32 million of whom regularly go to church. Millions of Christians in the U.S. indicate in a study released Monday that they are not likely to vote in the upcoming election in November, signaling a potential problem for the Republican Party. Just over half of interviewees, 51% in the center at Arizona Christian University study who identified as people of faith responded that they're likely to vote in the presidential election between Trump and Kamala Harris. The people of faith label given to those who identify with a recognized religion. The study found that approximately 104 million people under the people of faith umbrella are not expected to vote in this election, including 41 million born-again Christians and 32 million who regularly attend church. Well, I see two huge takeaways from this report, said Lee Munsell, president of Arizona Christian University, former Republican nominee for Arizona governor, said in a news release. First, Christians that could be the deciding factor in a bunch of federal and state races are choosing not to be. And second, that they're longing for their local church to instruct them on how to think biblically about policy and politics. They don't want to be told how to vote, but they do want to know why they should vote and how to view political issues from a biblical framework, he added. Research also revealed some of the reasons that Christians are not planning to vote in November, including a lack of interest in politics at 68%. A dislike in both major party candidates at 57%, and a belief that their vote will not make a difference at 52%. 48% believe that the election results will be manipulated. Quote, 32 million Christians who regularly attend church services but are not likely to vote represent a far larger margin than the combined number of votes that decided the 2020 election in key battleground states, the study's lead researcher said. If church leaders, family members, and close friends will use their influence to get reticent voters from their churches to cast a ballot, the election outcome will be meaningfully affected. Now, of course, not everyone who goes to church is going to vote Republican. We know that. Not every Christian is going to go out and vote for Donald Trump. Some will may vote for Kamala Harris. Some may vote for a third-party candidate. Some will just refuse to vote. But it is important to get out and vote. It's important for people who are of faith to get out and vote. You obviously want to, in my opinion, if you are a Christian, if you are someone of faith, I assume you want the world to be a better place. I assume you're wanting peace. I'm assuming that you're wanting to protect life. Obviously, not everyone out there is the same. Not everyone feels that way. But I look at it, and I ran into this discussion a few weeks ago of Christians who aren't voting, how do you encourage someone who looks at Donald Trump, looks at the current state of politics, and they don't want anything to do with it. They don't want anything to do with politics. They don't want anything to do with Donald Trump. They don't like Donald Trump personally, and they don't think they can vote for him. And I think what you have to remember, we've talked about this so many times, when it comes to Donald Trump, and we've talked about this with past candidates too, who is going to better represent your values? Who is going to better represent and fight for the things that you believe in? You look at the Democrat Party and where the Democrat Party stands when it comes to the issue of abortion alone. And the fact that so many Democrats are fine with abortion up until birth, that the Democrat Party that wants to levy heavier taxes against you, the Democrat Party that wants to have the Green New Deal that would come in and absolutely kill the Texas economy. This idea that you can't vote for Donald Trump because he doesn't seem like the utmost Christian man in the world. You have to separate that. You're not looking for who's going to be the most Christian person. You're not looking for who's going to be the preacher in chief. You're looking for someone who's going to fight for your values and fight for the American values. You have to separate if you're someone who just doesn't like Donald Trump, you have to separate the two and go, who's going to be fighting for the American values? Who's going to be fighting for the values that I hold closer? Does it skew towards Kamala Harris, or does it skew towards Donald Trump? It's a very important election. It is a very, very important election, and we need everyone out there to get out and vote. And especially when it comes to Republicans, you're going to have to get out and vote. Every vote matters. And for those people who think, oh, well, my vote doesn't matter, if you choose not to vote, remember, there are plenty of down-ballot races. And we've seen plenty of times where some of these campaigns, some of these races come down to just a handful of votes. Sometimes you get a small election where it comes down to a coin toss. So, yeah, every vote absolutely matters. Texter weighing in. It doesn't get more illogical than to think that if one side might cheat in an election, the right thing to do is for you to stay home and let them win without having to cheat. It's the same flawed logic that leads people to the conclusion that since Democrats made it so hard for Trump to get things done last time, they shouldn't vote for Trump this time. The Democrats tried to win. I guess we should just let them win. Yeah, no, if you think that there's going to be massive voter fraud, the answer is to outvote the fraud and to get more people out to vote. That's the answer. 806-680-2790. You can get your thoughts in on the text line. When we come back, your phone calls, your text messages. We'll also visit with Kim Sansom here in just a little bit with the Silver Spur Trade Show's Gun and Blade Show. We'll be right back.
The Titan of Texas Talk Radio, Chad Hastie.
Talking with newsmakers and about the issues that matter to you. The Chad Hastie Show, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m. Chad's show is also digital with the Chad Hastie Show podcast. The Chad Hastie Show podcast can be downloaded on Apple Podcasts, Amazon Music, Spotify, and the Radio On Demand page at KFYO.com. The Chad Hastie Show, all across Texas during your drive home, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton. Tuesday edition, Clay and Buck, 28 days, 4 weeks until Election Day. What is the absolute latest? We will break it down for you. Major hurricane barreling towards Florida. We'll certainly be talking about that. Buck.
Looking into the latest in the polls, Clay mentioned that election. We've just got weeks here, friends. Can Kamala turn it around? We'll discuss on Clay and Buck.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton, tomorrow morning at 11.
All right, back to the Chad Hastie Show. 1-800-687-0790. That's how you can give us a call. You can text in at 806-680-2790. We'll get back to the text line and some of your best, worst things from over the weekend. You can text in some of the best things that happened over the weekend, the worst things that happened over the weekend. You can get those in. I already know one of the best things that's going to be happening this upcoming weekend, the Gun and Blade Show back in Lubbock, Texas. Joining us on the phones right now to talk about the upcoming Gun and Blade Show, Kim Sansom with the Silver Spur Trade Show's Gun and Blade Show. Kim, welcome back. How are you today?
Well, I'm great. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. Of course, we're looking forward to being set up once again from 2 to 4 on Saturday out of the Gun and Blade Show. We'll be out there doing the live show and inviting people to stop on by and say hello. But you've got a full weekend of shows coming up here in Lubbock.
We sure do. We are so excited coming back to the South Plains, bringing a big show with lots of great vendors from all over Texas.
That's awesome. So about for those who maybe haven't attended in a while, what can they expect when they come inside the Civic Center and see the Gun Blade Show?
Well, of course, we have the new used and collectible guns, gun parts, magazines, people with body armor, gun bags, tactical guns and accessories, ammo, our reloading components and equipment guy who has expanded. So he has just about everything you need for reloading. Knives of all kinds, including custom knives, plus our knife sharpener will be there this show. He hasn't been there since early in the year, so we're excited to have him back. We got the first aid supplies and the bug out bags, survival gear, holsters, leather items, concealed carry purses, and gifts, and coins, and jewelry, and just a little bit of all kinds of stuff.
Yeah, you can find a little bit of everything at the Gun and Blade Show. And of course, this is a family friendly event, so bring the kids, bring everybody out to the Gun and Blade Show, because you'll probably see some neighbors and friends out there as well.
That's for sure. We do see a lot of people that are excited to see someone they haven't seen in a long time.
Absolutely. And will there be another hunter's education course?
Yes, there is a hunter education course. You can find a link, I believe, on our website, but our Facebook page has had one. Or you can go to the Texas Parks and Wildlife Department, twpd.org. And sign up for that, because you do have to sign up online. But that'll be Saturday from about 9 to 4-ish, 4:30. You know, not only is it good for your kids, which they have to have if they're going to hunt alone, but it's a good gun education course.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And, of course, you want to be a responsible gun owner. You want you want to have your kids educated about the firearms as well. Kim, how much do tickets cost, and what do people need to know about what time to get in and all that kind of good stuff this weekend at the Gun and Blade Show?
We'll be open Saturday 9 to 5, Sunday 10 to 5. Admission is $9 for adults. Kids 5 to 12 are $1, and we have a two-day pass for $15.
All right. Very good. And, Kim, of course, we're looking forward to being back out there from 2 to 4 p.m. on Saturday. And we'll talk to you again a couple of times this week.
That sounds great. Thank you.
Thank you. That's Kim Sansom with the Silver Spur Trade Show's Gun and Blade Show, coming back to Lubbock this weekend over at the Civic Center. And yeah, we do have tickets we'll be giving away, so stay tuned for that. Let's see, before some of the best and worst that came in, texter John from Pampa asking this question. Chad tried this last week, but I don't think it got through. Are Texas Republicans going to let one issue destroy the party? I am pro-life with three exceptions, but I also think saving this nation should rank up, rank toward the top of the priority list. I'm not sure exactly what you mean. Are Republicans going to let one issue destroy the party? What one issue is destroying the party? I'm not sure what issue that is. Are you talking about abortion? Are you talking about the issue of pro-life? Are you talking about the abortion issue is destroying the Republican Party? I don't see that the abortion issue is destroying the Republican Party. There is legitimate debate going on in America about how far some of these bans should go, but that's as it should be. There should be debate. We should welcome that. It's what we wanted. It's what we fought for. To have states and have the states decide what they were going to do about abortion, and that leads to debate. Now, the Democrats are using a lot of falsehoods. They're using a lot of lies to frame this debate. They're trying to say that this is a Trump ban or a Ted Cruz ban on abortion, but I don't see abortion destroying the Republican Party. And I'm not sure what you should Republicans not talk about it. Should we? I'm not sure what you mean by this. Here's how I will look at it. If you are talking about the abortion issue, When it comes to life, what else is there? What else matters? If we cannot come together and agree that life is precious and that we have to defend life, then what the hell does any of this mean? What does it matter if we if we don't have everything else that we're fighting for, if we can't agree that life is precious and worth defending? It all starts with life. So I would make the argument that nothing matters more than saying that we are going to be the people who defend life. And if there are people who don't agree with that, if there are people who don't like it, we can debate that. But I want to be part of the party that says we believe in life and we're going to defend life. Because without it, none of this other stuff matters. Now, can we defend the country? Absolutely. Can we save the country? Yes. But I think one of the ways we save the country is by saying we're going to protect life. We'll be right back.
The Chad Hastie Show, a presentation of the Texas Town Square Media Network. The views and opinions expressed during the Chad Hastie Show are not necessarily the views of this station staff, management, advertisers, or Town Square Media.
Go.
Broadcasting from the great state of Texas, this is the Chad Hastie Show. News and views with a Lone Star perspective. You can sound off during the show by sending Chad a text at 806-680-2790. That's 806-680-2790. Or call in at 1-800-687-0790. Now, here's Chad Hastie.
Welcome back to the Chad Hastie Show. Happy Monday. We will get back to your best things and worst things that happened over the weekend. I have quite a few texts that we've got to get to. I have not been very good at getting to the text line today. I apologize. But we will get to the text line. After we visit with our next guest, we'll take a look at what's happening in the world of Texas politics, because Texas politics, it never stops. Our good friend Scott Braddock, editor of QuorumReport.com, joining us right now on the phone. Scott, good evening. How are you today?
I'm doing well. The prayers, though, tonight for folks in Florida bracing for what is looking like just a disaster of a hurricane on the way. Hurricane Milton, Category 5, and if you're looking at the reports out of the Gulf of Mexico tonight, this thing is just going to deliver an incredible storm surge, high winds, all of that to those communities, and you have folks along the western coast of Florida getting out of there ASAP, and I was just watching some of the latest TV reporting on that, where you had journalists asking folks in various communities there about whether it's too late to get out ahead of the storm. In a lot of those places, folks are still packing up and getting out, Chad, but there does come a point where you got to hunker down and you can't leave where you're at, and that's when it gets really scary ahead of a storm like this. I was thinking back years ago, going back to 2005, the worst hurricane that I ever covered, and one of the worst on record, of course, is Hurricane Katrina, when I was reporting on the Gulf Coast in Houston and New Orleans. And this could be similar kind of damage to what we saw way back then. And this, of course, is right on the heels of Hurricane Helene, which was just so terrible going up into the states that were affected by that.
Yeah, and it's one of those where, you know, forget about the category number. I mean, it's, mm-hmm. you know, what we see now is it's not the wind. The wind doesn't help. But, you know, it's not right. The wind. It's the just massive amount of water That's going to be, a storm surge and then rain that's dropped on these communities. A lot of these communities that have already, they're still cleaning up from Helene in some of these areas. And so they're going to be dealt another blow, and that's no good. We don't like that. And so, yeah, you're right. Our prayers are out for the folks in Florida. That's for sure. Scott, when it comes to politics here at home, we've got Democrats endorsing Republicans. We got Republicans embracing Democrats. What's going on in this Senate race?
It's like the line from Ghostbusters where Venkman is saying, dogs and cats living together, end time stuff. So why do we have all this happening? By the way, I have a chance to talk to you. Just really cool, Chad. I'm just going to mention it. I'm also, in addition to everything else I do, a Quorum Report editor, host of the Texas Take podcast and all that. I'm also the executive producer of a show that is hosted by a friend of mine from Houston. And on the air the other day, he had Dan Aykroyd. I got to talk to Dan Aykroyd for a little bit. I have to tell you, and I'm not one of these guys who really cares about talking to celebrities or whatever, but this guy, who is one of the most famous people on the planet, right? Just talking to him, you wouldn't know that. I mean, just super nice, down to earth, totally unassuming. And we were chatting about a few different things, but that had me thinking about the Ghostbusters movies. For what I should binge watch, during October as we go into spooky season.
And
I just went back and watched a couple of them. Those are really genius movies. I mean, and they were really credited at the beginning of the era as being able to put things together, comedy and horror and all of that in one movie. But that line jumped to mind when I saw all this. It's sort of almost just weird. Season. Usually we talk silly season in October, but weird season with Democrats endorsing these Republicans. And I had a couple of people reach out to me, Chad, about the last Texas Take podcast where I had said that it seemed like Senator Cruz wasn't really reaching out across the political divide for votes from Democrats in the same way that Colin Allred is doing that. You've seen where Allred is going around promoting the endorsements of Liz Cheney and Adam Kinzinger, these Republicans who are disgusted with Trump about January 6th and all that. And we've talked about, whether that's going to work as a political strategy. I had said that I don't think that Cruz is doing the same thing. And I still stand by that, but he is doing some things. It's fair to say that. Yeah. So he does have a group called Democrats for Ted Cruz, which I'd like to meet any of them, as far as just rank and file voters out there. But you do have the sitting Harris County District Attorney, Kim Ogg, who is a Democrat. She was elected as a Democrat. I know that more progressive Democrats will say, well, she's not really a Democrat and she got beaten in her primary, but she is a Democrat. And by the way, her history was interesting. She ran originally for public office years ago as a Republican, and then switched over to the Democratic Party, and that was when she eventually won the Harris County DA's office. She lost the Democratic primary for that office earlier this year, so she's in office till the end of the year when they'll swear in the new guy coming up next year. But she says she's getting, this is interesting, this is more of Ted Cruz positioning himself as the bipartisan problem solver, which isn't really the way that he, ran for office all along before, going back to 2012. I mean, I think it's fair to say that he's had some evolution in the way that he's selling himself to people. I mean, you remember the 2012 primary and runoff against then Lieutenant Governor David Dewhurst. Who was Ted Cruz? He was the firebrand, constitutional, conservative all the way. And now he's, reaching out to some Democrats. I think it does speak to a changing political environment in the state in which both Allred and Cruz feel like they have to seem bipartisan, that both of them need to try to compete for people who might identify as independent voters. And if you look at the numbers, at least the public polling and some of the private polling I'm aware of, Senator Cruz's numbers among independents are not nearly as good as they were even the last time he was up for re-election, when he just squeaked by back in 2018. So you have Cruz now saying, hey, look, I've got the support of some Democrats, and some of y'all ought to vote for me. Meantime, down in South Texas, this is fascinating, you have something that I think is a legacy project for Lieutenant Governor Patrick. And this is a Senate race in the Valley for the state Senate. It's a rematch between the incumbent senator now, who is someone who's seen as a more moderate Democrat. It's the Valley. They don't really send progressive or liberal Democrats to Austin down there, Chad. In some cases, you might think that if they were running for office anywhere else, that they might run as Republicans. The Valley is, you know, a deep-seated, Democratic territory, but Republicans have had some success in picking up some ground there lately. Morgan LaMantia is the Democratic incumbent in the state Senate seat, and she now faces this fact in her reelection effort. The former senator who held that seat, also a Democrat, Eddie Lucio Jr., has now endorsed the Republican against the Democratic incumbent. And you have Lucio, who was also more moderate, I would even say a conservative Democrat, someone who Lieutenant Governor Patrick would often talk about as someone who's a proud pro-life Democrat. They were allies, you know, before the Lieutenant Governor decided that the Speaker needed to get rid of all the Democratic chairmen in the House. Before that, there was a time that Patrick would talk about bipartisanship, you know, and looking past just the R and D labels. And it's interesting that you have the chief political strategist for Patrick working on the challenger, Adam Hinojosa's campaign. And you have Lucio, who a couple of years ago endorsed the incumbent, LaMantia, but now is going against her. And the main argument that they're making against the incumbent is that she's not pro-life enough, that she's not, that this is somebody who, has cost conservatives a pro-life vote in the Texas Senate. But it's interesting, I think what's really going on here in the background, Chad, is you have the lieutenant governor really going into legacy mode. You know, he's someone who's in his 70s now. I don't know that he's going to run for office again. He says he is, but we'll see. We'll all stay tuned. They always have to say they're running again, you know, because nobody wants to be seen as a lame duck, right? In politics, you can't do that. In the background, you have Patrick raising money for Adam Hinojosa, aggressively doing so. I was told that Patrick was, and this was from multiple sources, he was on a call with some Aggies recently. It was a Zoom call where Patrick was reaching out to A&M system regents and asking them to give as much money as they can to Adam Hinojosa, who's trying to unseat LaMantia in South Texas. And when I was in South Texas last week in the Valley, some folks were asking me, what is this about? Why is Patrick really making this push of getting so behind Adam Hinojosa this time around? My thought on it is that he's in legacy mode. He has already, you know, remade the Texas Senate in a lot of ways in his image. It is, you know, often referred to as the much more conservative chamber in the Texas legislature. It has a solid majority of Republicans, and Patrick would like to, whenever he leaves, whenever that is, whether it's this term or if he ends up running for another term, he would like to leave it as Republican and as conservative as possible. And this is all part of his legacy project. So as part of this, it's interesting that Patrick's chief political consultant is now working for Hinojosa. That wasn't the case a couple years ago. And now Patrick and his consultant, I think, have been able to bring Lucio as a Democrat into the fold for the Republican who's trying to take down the Democratic incumbent. Fascinating stuff.
Hmm. Today, final day that people can register to vote. I think we'll see a big bump in numbers in the state of how many people are registered to vote this year.
Absolutely. I mean, we're approaching 20 million registered voters in this state, at a fast pace. And, you know, if you think about the number of registered voters that we have in Texas versus the last time Senator Cruz was up for reelection in 2018, we're looking at 3 million more registered voters or so. We'll see what the final numbers are when it all shakes out, Chad. But that's as if you had the entire state of Connecticut, if all of them voted, moved to Texas and get registered to vote. Now, we don't know that all those people are going to actually vote, right? You have to say that.
Yeah.
And we don't know exactly which party is having more success in registering voters who will, you know, lean their way. You always see that Democrats will do a big PR push, and they'll say that we're going to register this, you know, Beto O'Rourke does this, and other Democrats do this. They'll say, we're going to register a million new voters, or whatever number they want to put out. And I always kind of laugh about it, Chad, because that just means that Republicans then need to go find 1.5 million or however many would cancel that out. And I can tell you that the history of this is that Democrats talk a lot about it, and Republicans actually just go do it. In this state, there has been a real effort by those in the GOP, especially some of the legacy folks in the GOP, like Karl Rove, who of course was the engineer, as George W. Bush called him, the architect of his campaigns for governor and the White House. Rove has been in the background on this stuff, and a few of those other establishment Republicans, those who understand what it means to grow a party and not just purify a party, they have been working overtime to try to reach out to those people who have just moved to Texas and figure out if they're Republicans to register them to vote. And they are having a lot of success with that, you know, in the last couple of cycles. We'll see if that's the case this time around. But as you know, these statewide elections keep getting closer and closer, especially in these presidential years. The off years, that's a little different story, right? We had that one election in 2018 that was very, very close. And then the next time we had an off year election, it was a decisive victory for the Republicans. But more and more you see both sides really competing for those brand new people who are going to be participating in the vote coming up in November.
Well, and I can't wait to see because I'm sure we'll see this polling data come back after the election. But the last two presidential elections, we've seen where at least two polls have come, or two research studies, I guess, came back and showed that newer Texans, and this always surprises some of my listeners out there, that newer Texans voted more towards the Republican side than Texans who had been here their entire life. And we saw two different studies that came out, I think, in the last election that showed those who had been here less than 10 years voted more percentage-wise for the Republicans than those who had been here their entire lives. And I think that's kind of interesting.
It is. And I mean, you can imagine that for a lot of folks who are moving from, let's say, from California, for example, that's what Governor Abbott and the Lieutenant Governor Patrick and others always point to. You do have a lot of liberals, obviously, who have moved from California into Texas, and that changes the state's politics in one way, and that's obvious in some of our election results. But think about this. California, I mean, they're a giant Democratic state because Democrats just dominate the place, and there are way more Democrats there than there are here. But there are also more Republicans in California than there are in Texas. Right. It's just because it's a bigger state.
Yeah.
And so there are a lot of those folks who, you know, don't agree with the liberal, you know, stance of the state government. And so they move here. And that's true from, you know, from other states as well, where, you know, folks think that, you know, maybe they're getting overtaxed, overregulated and all that in these other places. And they move to Texas because they've been sold on the idea that this is the land of freedom, as Rick Perry and Governor Abbott always like to say. I think it's a mixed bag, but if you look at the 2018 election, to your point, it was true at that time that those who were native-born Texans trended to vote more for Beto O'Rourke than those who had moved more recently to Texas, who tended to vote more for Senator Cruz.
Yeah, so I guess that's why the Republicans have been out there trying to register these new people and
hard as they can.
Absolutely. Yep. Tell folks what else you're working on over at quorumreport.com.
We will, in the next 24 to 48 hours, start to see all of the 30-day reports. Think about it. We're just a month out from the election now, Chad. The 30-day campaign finance reports for these folks who are running for offices here in Texas. We'll get in-depth on that stuff and more for you at quorumreport.com. You can check it all out by clicking free sign up at quorumreport.com, and we'll get you going.
All right, very good. Scott, as always, appreciate your time. We'll talk to you next week.
Thanks, Chad.
That's Scott Braddock, editor, quorumreport.com. When we come back, your phone calls, your text, and more.
The Chad Hastie Show can be heard all over West Texas, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m. Tune in on News Talk 95.1 and 790 KFYO in Lubbock. News Talk 940 in Amarillo, News Talk 94.7 and 1470 KYYW in Abilene, and in Wichita Falls on News Talk 96.3 and 1290. The Chad Hastie Show. Make it a part of your drive home. Weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton. Tuesday edition, Clay and Buck. 28 days, 4 weeks until Election Day. What is the absolute latest? We will break it down for you. Major hurricane barreling towards Florida. We'll certainly be talking about that. Buck.
Looking into the latest in the polls, Clay mentioned that election. We've just got weeks here, friends. Can Kamala turn it around? We'll discuss on Clay and Buck.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton, tomorrow morning at 11.
Turn it up.
good song. I'm just going to let it go for a little bit. Back on the Chad Hasty Show. Thank you very much for tuning in. This portion of the show brought to you by my great friends over at First Bank and Trust Texas. Locations throughout Lubbock, the South Plains, the Big Country, and the Panhandle. With deep roots in Lubbock for over 30 years, your business deserves a bank and a financial partner that can help you grow. And at First Bank and Trust, they have the right tools and technology to help your business grow now and into the future. And they also have fantastic technology for personal banking as well. So if you're looking at making a switch to a great bank with fantastic options for personal banking and for business banking, do what I do for that. Make the switch to First Bank and Trust. First Bank and Trust, numerous locations to help you out and for you to make the switch. And they make the switch on you very easy. They can handle everything when it comes to making the switch to First Bank and Trust. So visit their website at firstbanktexas.com. That's firstbanktexas.com. Whether it's for personal banking or small business banking, the bank I trust, First Bank and Trust, Texas. 806-680-2790. All right, some texters weighed in with their best thing and worst thing that happened over the weekend. Patrick from Lawton, good thing I was working on a 1980 Mongoose motorbike or Motomag bicycle that I bought. Bad thing is wife doesn't appreciate my bike. I'm 63. Another texter, Lawrence weighing in. Couple of best things this weekend. Hanging out with my youngest son at Oktoberfest in Fredericksburg. Received two warnings for speeding on the drive down Friday morning. The worst. Left Oktoberfest earlier than we expected on Saturday due to 10 hours of beer, heat, and walking. Number two, lost twice at the Stein hoisting competition. Came in second place both times. When we come back, more of your text messages, your phone calls, best things and worst things that happened over your weekend. Let us know at 806-680-2790. We'll be right back.
The Chad Hasty Show, weekdays 5 to 7 p.m. Sound off during the show by sending Chad a text at 806-680-2790. Today's markets from the Texas Department of Ag.
Well, howdy, neighbors. Texas feeder catalog reported prices steady to $4 lower. Cattle futures were mixed. October live cattle futures up 47 cents, closed at 187.47. October feeder cattle futures down 78, closed at 248.85. October cotton futures are up, closing at 73.29. December wheat futures up a nickel, closed at 6.03 a bushel. December corn up a penny to close at 4.26. And November soybean futures down 4 cents, closed at $10.34 a bushel. October soybean meal futures down $5.70, closed at $324.80 per ton. October class 3 milk futures down a nickel, closed at $22.51 a hundred. November crude oil futures up $2.95. Cents, trading at $77.33 a barrel. The Dow Jones down 398 points, closed at 41,954. And that's Market Roundup from the Texas Department of Agriculture. I'm your commissioner, Sid Miller. And remember, friends, Texas agriculture matters. So.
The news and talk of West Texas. News Talk 95.1 and 790 KFYO. You're listening to The Chad Hasty Show.
All right, back on The Chad Hasty Show. Thank you for tuning in today. Of course, we're taking your best and worst things that happened over the weekend, your best worst list from over the weekend. We do this now every Monday. Every Monday, best and worst. Let's see, Elizabeth in Lubbock weighed in. Best thing that happened this weekend was I stayed on task and on target the whole time. I got stuff done. Worst thing, there wasn't anything bad, so this is difficult. I guess worst thing was I didn't finish folding and put away all the laundry. How about that Trump rally in Butler, Pennsylvania, Trump's opening line, which was brilliant. So as I was saying, that was maybe the best thing that happened this whole weekend. I think Trump cemented his win for the 2024 election. That's a win for all Americans. Frankly, I think it's a win for the entire world. I'll take that as the best thing that happened this weekend. Well, I won't say it's a done deal yet. I'm liking the trends that I'm seeing. I do like some of the trends that I'm seeing out there. And over the weekend, it just, I don't know. There's part of me, and I was getting into this discussion with a few folks over the weekend, that, you know, everyone expects us to come down to a few swing states, and it's going to be a razor-thin election. There is part of me that goes, it's not going to be as close as we think. There's part of me that goes, this is not going to be as close as we think, and that we'll know fairly early in the night how this thing is going, and that it's going to get wrapped up fairly quickly. Now, I'm not saying by 10 p.m. By any means, but that, you know, we're not going to be waiting until the next day to figure out who the next president is going to be. But then there's part of me that thinks that this, it's not going to be as close, and that Trump is going to, he's going to win North Carolina. He's going to win Pennsylvania. He's going to win the red states that he needs to win, and that it's going to be a done deal. And, I want Trump to run like he's 10 points down. I want Republicans to think, you know, that they're down and get out and vote. But there's just part of me that goes, this thing may not be as close as is projected. That it may be a little bit different come election night. Let's see. Another texture weighted bill. North Carolina says, always the best part is on Saturdays when it's pup all day. Worst is on Mondays. And from Bill, North Carolina. And then received this text. This is from Rick early in the day. Chad, I saw a political yard sign today that said Republicans for Harris. How could someone call themselves a Republican and vote for a communist? Or do you think it's just a ruse to trick the never-Trumpers into voting for Harris? That from Rick in Lubbock. Listen, there are Republicans. There are people who consider themselves Republicans who are going to vote for Kamala Harris. It's not a big group. It's not a big group of people, but you look at the Mitt Romneys, you look at the Liz Cheneys of the Republican Party, they still call themselves Republicans. They still call themselves Republican. In fact, there was a story, I think it was Wall Street. It was either Wall Street Journal or Washington Post. I'll have to go back and look. That said that there are a number of reasons why Republican voters can vote for Kamala Harris. There's a number of reasons why Republican voters can cast a vote for Kamala Harris. I can't see one. I will obviously not be casting a vote for Kamala Harris. I can't see a reason to vote for her at all. But there are Republicans out there who they consider themselves Republicans. They consider themselves they're the ones who they know more than we do, right? They're better than us because they're putting country before party is their line. We're putting the country before party. Yes, the country, we're because if Donald Trump becomes president, the country will fall. Democracy will fall. They have bought into this narrative that is completely false and completely made up, that somehow if Donald Trump's elected, then he'll become a dictator and that he'll never leave and that the country will fall apart. They bought into it. They hate the guy so much that they have bought into this idea that they are putting country before party. When, again, if you look at the policies being endorsed by Donald Trump, forget his name. If he were any other candidate, if it was Ron DeSantis with the same policies, they'd be voting for Ron DeSantis, maybe. They just don't like the guy. They don't like Trump. And they have fallen for this idea that Trump is a bad guy, that Trump is an evil guy, when it has been Joe Biden and the Democrats that have made this country a worse place to be right now, that have made us the laughingstock of the world, a country that is not respected around the world. That's the Democrats. The Democrats have done that. Kamala Harris, did you see over the weekend when Kamala Harris's teleprompter went out for a few seconds? And she couldn't remember what she was saying. She couldn't remember the script. So she kind of froze up and just kept on repeating the number 32. In 32 days to vote. 32 days until the election. Meanwhile, Donald Trump, and he gets in trouble because he does go off script so often. But the guy doesn't have to have a teleprompter. To give a speech, you don't have to have a teleprompter for Donald Trump. He can wing it, and he does many times. If you've ever been to a rally of Donald Trump's, you know that he can wing it, and he can speak for a long time. I think it's funny that Democrats make fun of the guy for speaking for a long time and that his rallies are long, but that's what he does. He wants to put on the show for folks. And he wants to give people a lot of information. I'm telling you, as someone who has been to a Trump rally, people love it. People are waiting hours and hours and hours to get in. And yes, I think the rally that he had over the weekend in Butler was very smart. It was fantastic. I thought it was funny. I thought it was poignant. I thought that they did a very good job of taking a moment of silence, and it was a very good rally, and he had millions of people online watching. Millions and millions of people were on YouTube and other places watching the rally over the weekend. So it was a good thing for Trump. 806-680-2790. When we come back, we'll begin to wrap things up. Your phone calls, your text, and much more when we return.
Well, south side of Chicago is the baddest part of town.
The Titan of Texas Talk Radio, Chad Hastie.
Talking with newsmakers and about the issues that matter to you. The Chad Hastie Show, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m. Chad's show is also digital with the Chad Hastie Show podcast. The Chad Hastie Show podcast can be downloaded on Apple Podcasts, Amazon Music, Spotify, and the Radio On Demand page at KFYO.com. The Chad Hastie Show, all across Texas during your drive home, weekdays from 5 to 7 p.m.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton. Tuesday edition, Clay and Buck, 28 days, 4 weeks until Election Day. What is the absolute latest? We will break it down for you. Major hurricane barreling towards Florida. We'll certainly be talking about that. Buck.
Looking into the latest in the polls, Clay mentioned that election. We've just got weeks here, friends. Can Kamala turn it around? We'll discuss on Clay and Buck.
Clay Travis and Buck Sexton, tomorrow morning at 11.
Oh.
Chad Hastie Show. Text that just came in, this from Kim, and not hearsay. Both of my daughters live in the Tampa area. My oldest daughter called me directly after her FEMA appointment yesterday. She lived in the Madeira Beach, Florida, until it flooded in Hurricane Helene and lost everything. Yesterday, she had a FEMA appointment. The lady was 3 hours late. Mind you, this is 9 days in. She was told that in 2 weeks, she would either get an email denying her claim or she would get anywhere between $25 and $750. This is not per person. This is per household. 2 more weeks. Any money above $750 would be a loan. And Joe Biden says everybody's happy. I'm telling you, everyone is crying a lot and walking around like zombies because they are suffering from PTSD. And to top it off, there's another hurricane coming. That's a direct hit. Yeah, that's a mean-looking hurricane that is on its way towards Florida right now. And our prayers are with everybody there. And they're encouraging people to get out and to, you know, get away as quickly as possible as this new hurricane that's out there has now gone into a category five hurricane is what Hurricane Milton is at. And the wind is supposed to dissipate a little bit by the time it slams into Florida. But the Tampa Bay area, they are preparing for a massive storm surge. And this is, like we visited with Scott Braddock earlier, it really doesn't matter how high the winds are. You know, what kills so many people and what really does so much damage now is the storm surge and the flooding and the rain that goes with these hurricanes and these storms. And you've had so much of, you know, that area that has been impacted, obviously, by Helene. They're still cleaning up. Kim sent some pictures from her daughter's house. It's just horrible. I mean, just the damage is just terrible. Up and down the street, and now you've got another one on its way. And it's supposed to be historic for the Tampa area. But, the administration, people should be upset. People should be very, very upset and disheartened about the federal response and this, people are happy. Joe Biden saying people are happy and that they're being taken care of. They're not. You have people who are denying that FEMA has prevented helicopters from landing in North Carolina and delivering food and water and baby formula when there's case after case after case of this being proven that it's happening. And this idea that we're going to give American citizens $750, I hate to say this, Kim, but if your daughter was an illegal immigrant, she'd be given $5,000 and would be given a nice hotel room in New York City. You know, that's what we do for those who sneak into the country. We give them $5,000, give them a cell phone, make sure they're fed, and put them up in a nice hotel. If she was a Palestinian, we'd be sending aid her way, in millions of dollars in aid her way. If she was Ukrainian, she'd be getting a lot more money. But if you're just a U.S. citizen, if you're somebody who's a U.S. citizen, well, yeah, we'll help you out eventually. Eventually, we'll help you out. Maybe after the election, yeah, we'll help you out at some point. You'll get $750, and you can pull yourself up by yourself at that point, right? And then you've got Kamala Harris, who has said in the past that when it comes to disaster assistance, what we really need to focus on is the minority communities. That's due to equity. We have to really focus first on the minority community because they're the ones who are hit the hardest. This is what Kamala Harris has said in the past, folks. Not making it up. You can go and look it up. So, yeah, people should be outraged. They should be very unhappy. They should be very upset at how the news media really hasn't even covered what's happening in North Carolina and what's happening in Florida and elsewhere due to Helene. And now you have Milton on its way, and you know, God help the people in Florida. Because whether it's a Category 3 hurricane or Category 4 or 5 hurricane that slams into Florida, it's going to do a lot of damage, and a lot of people will... If they haven't lost what they already, if they haven't lost everything already, they may lose it, lose what they do have. And so we hope it doesn't happen. We hope it, I mean, you know, I don't know. Yeah, yeah, you hope it's overblown, but that's an area where they are urging people to definitely get out of the way. And Kim, we hope you're, your daughter is safe as well. Both of them. All right. Tomorrow, we'll be back getting into the news of the day. We'll have tickets to give away to the Gun and Blade show. Your phone calls on all the latest issues. We'll be another day closer to the election. We'll be getting into that. Follow me on social media at Chad Easty Radio. That's at Chad Easty Radio. Check out the Current and Cask podcast and the Chad Easty Show podcast, available on all podcast platforms. Enjoy the rest of your evening. Stay safe. Stay healthy. God bless you all. We'll see you back here tomorrow at 5 p.m.
The Chad Easty Show, a presentation of the Texas Town Square Media Network. The views and opinions expressed during the Chad Easty Show are not necessarily the views of this station's staff, management, advertisers, or Town Square Media.